Hello guys, welcome back to my channel. Today I'm gonna discuss first three problems of today's CodeSafe Starter Contest 106 Division 2. So I solved first three problems and tried fourth and fifth one, but didn't get success. Anyways, let us discuss about first three problems. So as usual, I will be first explaining the problem statement, and then I will explaining the logic behind the problem, and then at last I will explaining the code. So the first problem was titled as playing with or. So problem statement was, we are given an array A of length n containing n integers and an integer k, and k is greater than 1, greater than or equal to 1, and less than equal to n. So we have to find the number of subarrays of A with length k whose bitwise or is odd. So if we look at the constants, it is 5 into 10 to the power 5, so we can use only one for loop here. And if we think about the brute force way, so we take each subarray of length k and find its bitwise or and check if it is odd or even, then obviously it will exceed the time limit error. So it will give a time limit error, right? So what we can do here? So let me move to whiteboard. So let's say we have an array of length n. So the given array has elements a1, a2, a3, a4, a5, dot dot, an. And we have given an integer k, right? So the first thing we have to keep in mind is we have to find the number of subarrays with length k having its bitwise or as odd. So first let's talk about the binary representation of any odd number. So any odd number has LSB as 1. So the least significant bit is always 1 for odd number. Let's suppose 5. So the LSB of 5 is 1, which is 5 is an odd number. So if we take any odd number, the LSB will always be 1. And for even number, LSB is 0, right? So this was the first thing. And now for bitwise or to be odd, let's say we take some elements, right? Like a1, a2, a3, a4. We take 4 elements. Let's say k is 4. And we take 4 elements. So if we take bitwise or of all these 4 elements, so if any of these 4 elements, or I should say at least one of them, is an odd number, then our or bitwise or will always be odd, right? So if any of the least significant bit is 1, or at least one bit is 1, then our or also have one at its least significant position. So that was the logic. So what we will be going to do is just iterate through the array and take the portion of length k and check if at least one and we check if at least one odd elements is present between them. So let's suppose k is 4. So what I will be doing is, let's say we have n is equal to let's say 6. So what I will be doing is, I will be iterating through the each element. So let's suppose I start at the first index and take let's say k is 4. So I take the length as 4. So subarray starting from a1 and ending at a4. So if at least one odd elements is present between a1 and a4, then obviously our bitwise or will be odd. So what I will be doing is, I will be storing the number of odd elements up to any index, like up to each index. So let's store it in a vector. So b i will represent the number of odd elements up to ith and x, right? So that was the simple logic, and we will pre-compute this vector v, and then we will see. So let me explain you the code, then it will become more clear. So yeah, so this is the code. So I have checked for n is equal to 1 here. So if n is 1 and a0 is odd, so obviously our answer will be 1, and if n is 1 and a0 is even, then obviously answer will be 0. Now else, this is the vector to store number of odd elements up to the ith index. So these steps are done to store the number of odd elements up to ith index. So simply, if ai is odd, then bi will be vi minus 1 plus 1. And if ai is even, then it will be equal to bi minus 1. Now I am initializing our answer to 0. And yeah, so why I have taken this, I plus k minus 1 should be not exceeding the last index of the array. So I have used this if statement. Now if I is equal to 0, if bi plus k minus 1 isn't equal to 0, means there is at least one odd element between I plus k, sorry, 0th index and I plus k minus 1 index. So I will increase answer. And if I is not equal to 0, then to check if there is any odd elements, we can simply check if bi plus k minus 1 is not equal to bi minus 1. That means there is at least one odd element present between ith index and I plus k minus 1th index. So I will again increase the answer variable, and simply I will output the answer. So that was the approach to solve this problem. So moving on to the next problem, it was titled as guess the winner. So as you can see in this problem, we have some moves, and there are two players, Elias and Bob, right? So they start with an integer n and take turns with Elias going first. So in this, on their turn, a player must select an odd prime factor p of n. So we have to select, in each step we have to select odd prime factor, right? So the first thing we should keep in mind is we can't take 2, because 2 is even prime factor, and 2 is the only even prime factor. So we can't take 2, and also we can't take 1, because 1 is not a prime number. Then after that, this question was a pure observation based, so I'm not gonna discuss much about this. You can simply see that if n is even, then the answer is Bob, and if n is odd, then answer is Elias, except one case. When n is 1, then answer will be not Elias, but answer will be Bob. Why? Because if n is equal to 1, then in the first turn Elias can't make any move, because 1 has only one factor, which is 1, and that is not an odd prime factor, or we can say it is not even prime factor, right? So for n is equal to 1, answer will be Bob, and for all n except one that is odd, answer will be Elias, and for all n that is even, answer will be Bob. So that was the, I think this was only observation, so I don't think there is any logic behind this problem. So let me just, give me a second. Yeah, so moving on to the third problem, I would say this was a good problem. So first, let's understand about the problem statement. So without going into much detail, I will be explaining the problem statement simply. So we have given a 2D grid with n rows and m columns. So the cell at the intersection of ith and jth column, sorry, ith row and jth column is denoted as I comma j. So Ceph can select exactly one non-infected cell and vaccinate it. Sorry, initially only cell XY of the grid is infected. So let's see this grid. So initially, it is given that one of the cell I comma j is infected, right? So initially x comma y of the grid is infected. Now Ceph can select exactly one non-infected cell and vaccinate it. So we can select any exactly one non-infected cell and vaccinate it. And then the infection and the vaccine is spread across the grid as follows. So first, any cell that is neither vaccinated nor infected, but is adjacent horizontally or vertically to an infected cell becomes infected itself. And similarly, for any cell that is neither vaccinated or infected, but is adjacent to a vaccinated cell becomes vaccinated itself. This process repeats till every cell in the grid is either infected or vaccinated, right? So let me go on to the whiteboard. So here is a grid of n rows and n column. So let's suppose the initial infected grid is this one, so denoted with red dot, right? So it is like 3 comma 3, right? And we have a freedom to choose the first non-infected grid and vaccinate it. So we can choose any of them. So we have to choose that one which will give the maximum non-vaccinated, sorry, non-infected people. So let's see the problem statement again. So we have to find the maximum possible number of vaccinated cells Ceph can obtain if he chooses the initial position of vaccine optimally, right? So let's understand how the infection is spreading, right? So let's suppose I choose the first cell to vaccinate as this one. Now, in the first step, this cell, and this cell will be infected. Then, in the second blow, this cell, and this cell will be vaccinated, right? Now, similarly, in the third throw, sorry, this cell, this cell, this cell, this cell, this cell, this one is vaccinated, right? Similarly, it will spread like this one. This, again, this, like that. So, what we choose initially so that we have a maximum number of non-infected and vaccinated people at the end. So the one observation was that, let me just clear it. So initially the infection was only present at 3 comma 3, right? Now the observation is that we can block the first, I mean the first adjacent cell. How? So initially I can choose this one. If I choose this cell, then at the end all these cells will be vaccinated and all these cells will be infected, right? Similarly, in the first step, I can choose this cell and this all part will be vaccinated and this bottom part will be what? Will be infected. Similarly, in the first step, if I choose this one, then this part will be vaccinated and this part will be like infected. So we have four ways to choose the initial cell to vaccinate it, right? So what I will do is I will try all those four possible ways and I will output the maximum maximum vaccinated people among those four. So that was the logic behind this problem. So I will again explain it quickly. So we have a cell here. The most, what I am saying is, if infection is present, for example, here, the most optimal way where to place, where to vaccinate the first element is either this one, this one, this one, or this one. So we have four ways. So I will check all those four possibilities and I will output the maximum value. And the second thing which I am saying is, if I am, let's say, placing, if I am vaccinating the first cell, this first cell, then at the end, you can see by observation that this all cell will be vaccinated and this all cell will be infected. So it is easy to calculate the number of these cells, right? Similarly, if the first, if we choose this cell as first to be vaccinated, then all these upper cells will be vaccinated at the end, and all these, this one, lower cells will be infected at the end. So that was the logic behind this problem, and let's quickly move to the code. So after understanding the logic, the code is super simple. So this is the code. Like, we have taken input of n and m, where n is number of rows and m is number of columns, and x, y, the initial coordinates of the cell which is infected, right? So the first, the variable p, I am storing when I will be placing the first, when I will be choosing the first element to be vaccinated as the right most element, I mean the element present just right to the infected cell. And this is for the cell which is just below the infected cell, and this is for, I mean, this vaccinated cell which is just at the upward side of the first infected cell, and similarly this is for downward side. And at last I will be outputting, I am outputting the maximum value among those, because we are asked to output the maximum value. So I hope you understood all these problems. If you find this video helpful, you can like the video. Thank you.